We thank you that week by week we can freely gather here, that we can soak in a little bit more of your word. That week by week, that faithfulness, that willingness to hear your voice will change us, will make us more like you want us to be, like you created us to be, and will draw us closer to you. We thank you, Lord, for the relationship we have in you. We thank you, Lord, that we can freely hear your word. We ask, Lord, that we would listen with all our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to continue with 442. I know whom I have believed. And I believe that's a quote directly from 2 Timothy 1:12. And he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day, I believe. That's what the chorus is, a directly quote. Okay?
Surgery that she had, so please be in prayer for Ms. Ruth. And George Riceburg is home, and he's doing well. So thank you for your prayers for George Riceburg. And there's a new address for Luke Donato. His address is up there, and Lauren and Nick as well, down in Augusta, West Virginia. So we have addresses for them, if you can send them anything. And is there anything else that I missed?
Poor Luke can't escape us. He was visiting a local church up there, and Christine was visiting that same church. He sat with him.
So New Women's Bible Study led by Jess Meyer, be once a month on Tuesday at 7 p.m. will be here in the back room of the church. Yes.
Does everybody have a study guide? If you don't, let me know, and I'll make copies of mine before I write it in. Just let me know so I can make copies.
All right. Let Jess know if you need a study guide for the Women's Bible Study.
One more thing. It's Olivia's 6th birthday today.
Today is Olivia's 6th birthday. Happy birthday, Olivia. You grew up so fast. So, Bill?
Did we hear anything about Jim Duff? Did I miss something?
I haven't heard anything else about Jim Duff. I need to call Kelly or, you know, see if I can get hold of somebody and find out.
He's not well enough to travel. He has ongoing issues. Something about being older is not fun.
So, Hank was saying that Jim Duff is not able to travel. He's still having some issues. So, continue to pray for Jim. And we'll see if I can get a hold of Kelly and find out, you know, what's going on with Jim.
We're passing around a sign-up sheet for next week.
Okay. There'll be a sign-up sheet. There's a sign-up sheet coming around for next Sunday. The Sunday spread, food and fellowship in the back, so there's a sign-up sheet coming around for that.
And I wrote on there, like, if you don't feel obligated to bring anything, you can just come and feed you anyway. But if you have something that can be brought ahead of time and, like, left in the fellowship hall, it'll just be easier to have it out for all those folks that show up way early.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, so if you're bringing things for them, you can leave them down in fellowship hall or refrigerator if you'd like, and then we can get them out early.
All right.
Okay. Any announcements from anyone? It's in the back. Okay. Daily bread. There's a copy of that in the back. If somebody would like to take a look at that. Any other announcements?
Oh. And I have pencils I'm selling on behalf of the school, so if you'd like to buy a pencil.
Terry's selling pencils on behalf of the school, so.
But did you say you're only selling them through your Sharp students?
Yes. I don't serve all customers.
I wasn't really sharp. I got a pen.
Special music.
Jerry has lots of slots for special music, and if you don't fill them, this is what you get.
Thank you. Father, we give thanks that you've shown your compassion to us in Christ, given us salvation. Thank you for Hank and Patty and their ministry here, and Terry, and the church. May we live for your glory. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. We're looking at Acts chapter 16. In fact, we'll be in Acts 16 this week and next next week, giving you a summary of part of the chapter and then narrowing it down to some verses. Today, a woman whose heart the Lord opened. In Acts 16, we have the Apostle Paul, as he would do, went back and visited some of the churches he ministered in. So in Acts 16, it talks about him going back and visiting some previous churches. We do that. We enjoy going back and visiting churches. Already scheduled for the third Sunday in November, New Carrollton Bible Church anniversary. It's a standing invitation. So we're glad to go back and see the folks. Some of them once a year. Some of the previous churches I go back more frequently for funerals. I like anniversaries better than funerals, but it's part of the ministry. So Paul was doing this and journeying on his way. And as he finished these churches, they were found, while he's there, go ahead and preach over here. And you'll find here that when he went there, the Holy Spirit, in verse 6, the Holy Spirit said, don't go there. That's interesting when you're in the ministry. The Holy Spirit says, don't go there. So he couldn't go this way. So they're in what today would be called Turkey, Asia Minor. They're headed west. Can't go north. So they kept going further west. God said, can't go south. The only way you go is keep going west. So you find them in verse 16:8. They came by Mysia and came to Troas. When you're in Turkey, headed west, Turkey as far as you can go. The road stops there. Here down where, here's the sea all around him. The Spirit said, don't go there, don't go here. Paul's thinking, what am I doing here? Why am I here? If you were wanting to go southeast in Maryland, you could leave here and down Baltimore, then go down to Annapolis and pick up Route 2, go down through Teller County, cross the bridge in St. Mary's County. When you get to Point Lookout, that's as far as you can go on land. Potomac's here, Chesapeake Bay is there. What are all around you? What are you going to do? So while Paul is in Troas, verse 9, and a vision appeared to him in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and said, come over to Macedonia and help us. Isn't it interesting? God shut down this way. God shut down that way. You can't go any further west. He wasn't going to go back. What are you going to do? Now, what we have here then is Paul had gone in Turkey as far as you can go on land. God said, I want you to go across the sea into Greece. The gospel had been in Europe. I mean, it had been in Asia. A couple weeks ago, the Ethiopian, the gospel went down to Africa. Now the gospel is going to go to Europe. So we have this vision of a man saying, come over and help us. And the Bible tells us here that they assumed this. We endeavored to go to Macedonia, assured together, the Lord had called us to go. So they go along, and they go by a couple of cities until we get to verse 12. From there to Philippi, which is a chief city of that part of Macedonia, a colony, we were there abiding certain days. So they're in Philippi, that's in Greece. They're headed west. Verse 13, the Sabbath day went by. They went to the riverside and the prayer was there and there were women there. And now our text for the day. And a certain woman named Lydia. It's been interesting in our life, my wife and I together, how the Lord has led us. But the Lord has always led us to people. We're not just on a tour. When we started New Carrollton Bible Church, there were some people in the mother church. It was going fine. I mean, we had a church of 150, took it to 200, and we just were sitting the crowd out and didn't know what to do further. The Lord had to start New Carrollton Bible Church. Later on, people challenged us, why did you start New Carrollton Bible Church? I said, you see Mike and Tina? That's the reason we came here. Mike is going through bone marrow transplant, and our church is praying for him. And I knew the things in his family, so I began to point out the people in New Carrollton Bible Church. My next door neighbor, Jerry, he wouldn't go 6 miles to where I was, but he'd go across the street. So the reason why we started New Carrollton Bible Church were people. Why is he in Philippi? Is he on a tourist trap? No. There's a lady named Lydia. And so some of the things about Lydia before her salvation. It says a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple. I believe everything in the Bible is here for a reason. So it tells us what she did for a living. She was what we would call today a successful businesswoman. She sold purple. Now that's clothing. That was special clothing worn by leaders and the affluent. The upper 1%. It was expensive. So she was selling these kind of clothes. In the Bible, it talks about it. When Queen Esther went into the king on behalf of the Jews, she wore purple. Got the king's attention. We have the parable of the rich young ruler that came to Jesus. What was he doing? Wearing purple. When Jesus was being tried before the crucifixion, they put on him a royal robe in mockery. So purple had a special meaning. It meant she was with the affluent people in that town, had good connections, which later on, you're going to see, she used them to bring people to Christ. But then it goes further on to say, of the city of Thyatira. Again, everything in the Bible, I believe, is here for a reason. Thyatira was back in Turkey. She's in Greece. The home base was back in Turkey about 200 miles. Now, they didn't have the metro train in those days. So it took some time to get from Philippi back to Thessalonica. And the woman was from that area, and it tells us in the book of Revelation a couple of things about it. Now look at history, and their main god was the sun god. Apollo. Now they did get a church started. And the book of Revelation in Revelation 2:20 says, that church had a problem. God says, I have something against the church in that city because you have the woman named Jezebel. Now ladies, if somebody ever calls you a Jezebel, that is not a good description. Is that the woman Jezebel teaches and seduces and has people worshiping idols. So she was from a city that worshiped the sun god, and when the church was built, they had false teaching. I think God spared her all that by being 200 miles away. Now I've mentioned to you that in my ministry, walking with the Lord, I grew up in a Christian church, believed the Word of God. When I got saved, I didn't have to change any theology. I heard about Bible stories, right away, straight along, and Reverend Sullivan that I've mentioned here, and connected with this church, I accept the Lord. But some people don't always have that. My wife did not grow up in a Christian home. It was worse than that. She had a relative that was in what we call a cult. And she went to that church. They do not believe in the shed blood of Christ. They don't think the blood of Christ has any value. And so they taught Bible stories. So Jackie got the story about Jesus walking on water and doing all these various things. Daniel lines in, David and Goliath. But then when they began to bring the teaching in, they taught there's no sin, there's no sickness, just in your mind, and started teaching false doctrines. Thankfully, Jackie's mother was aware that that's not right and pulled her out of that. Now, Betty in our church here was in a cult. And it's a little more difficult when you've got to unlearn. With me, everything was done correctly and accepted Jesus. But the sum is difficult. So I look at Lydia's background and believe that God spared her from all these false doctrines. It's sad today how many false religions we have teaching things that are not correct. But look at her. It says she worshiped God. Well, it may be relatives back home were being seduced by a woman named Jezebel, worshiping the sun god. She had this heart toward the Lord. The word worship means utmost respect, feeling of awe, of devotion. John 4:23 says, true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. The Father seeks such to worship him. Jeremiah 29:13, you shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. The question all of us have to ask today is this. Are we satisfied with what we know about God and the Bible? We say, I know enough. Or is there still a desire to know more? Are we still growing the knowledge and grace of Christ? People today are satisfied not going to church, satisfied not knowing the Lord, satisfied not reading the Bible. When we don't read the Bible, it seems like a day missing. I mean, we read it this morning in Jeremiah. And I said, what? What God said about Egypt, what he's going to do to Egypt and their river. Said, wow. And it happened. And so the things in the Bible that you're reading, it's a new insight all the time. Reading the same Bible, but circumstances are different. I mean, the last 2 years with COVID, reading through the Bible, as I mentioned to you last year, reading through COVID, through Job, we both got COVID, banged in the car, inside the house. I couldn't wait to get out of Job. I said, we got to get to the book of Psalms. It's killing me. This year, going through the book of Job, that's a vocal cord problem. So here we go again. But you learn things from the Bible. So she was worshiping the Lord. Matthew 7 says, ask, and shall be given. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the door shall be opened. So the Lord wants us to seek him. I'm convinced a lot of times God just puts me in a spot where I can't handle. I would think by this time I pretty well handled everything that came along until, oh, I hadn't thought about that. So God wants us to seek him, worship him, follow him. But then it says that she worshiped the Lord God. She heard us. That word means to hear with understanding. And it's a Greek word which means she kept on hearing. Now you folks apparently think it's worth going to church today. I have a lot of neighbors in Thurmont that grew up in church, but didn't bring their family to church. One of my neighbors said, my regret is I didn't take my children to church. I can't believe that. You get enough of going to church when you're young. At my age, I'm glad I know the Lord, glad I go to church, glad I'm among Christian friends, glad I'm walking with the Lord, glad I'm gonna see the Lord someday, hope the rapture, undertaker, not undertaker, but either way, we know where we're going. So God wants us to continue to hear with understanding. understanding what the Word of God is. Now, my second point then, the title of the sermon. She worshiped God. God heard her, whose heart the Lord opened. This is the key to the whole message here today. We might think, well, you know, I was pretty smart to figure this thing out. Wow, I got all this great intelligence. Or maybe there are ministers that think, wow, people are wooed by my preaching. I'll tell you something, as a minister, if God doesn't open hearts, it's like talking to a wall. I don't open hearts. It doesn't say the preacher did. It said the Lord opened. And it has the idea, open up completely. And that's what happens when you receive Jesus. It opens up completely. As I said, when I accepted Jesus, theology didn't change. But I remember how I felt going to church that night, how I felt going home that night. It was like, yes, it is true. And God shows you that's what it means, just opening up totally. The same word is used in Luke 24, and that's with Jesus on the road to Emmaus. These two fellows walking along, and they're so sad because they heard about Jesus, and they heard about him dying, they heard about being buried, they heard about being resurrection, and we would say, yes! But they were saying, we thought he was going to deliver us. And then it says, Jesus began to open their eyes. Wow. They were walking, can you imagine walking along the road with Jesus and didn't even know it was Jesus? The word is used three times. It says he opened their eyes. Then it says he opened the scriptures. That's one of the things that helped me when I was in Washington Bible College. How the Word of God opened. Before I went to Bible College, we had a girl from our church that went to Washington Bible College. And I have to confess, I gave her a hard time. You're going to Washington Bible College. How many books of Bible you got down there? 66, I got them here. You go to Bible school, I go to Sunday school. I said, Bible college is like a glorified Sunday school. And the Lord called me to Washington Bible College. And I never saw a Sunday school like that. And the teachers that had studied the Word of God and how things began to open. And they're still being open. I'm still reading. In fact, every sermon I preach, I keep my notes. And I go back in my previous notes, and I'll think, why didn't I see that? Why did I miss that? So God is still opening the scriptures, and they make more sense. Especially Bible prophecy. When you see what's happening around the world today, and you see the things in the book of Revelation, we're getting closer than I thought we would, but we know the Lord's going to come. So he opens the scriptures. And then it's verse 45, he opened their understanding. So God opened to the woman what Paul was preaching. That's what it is. And that's what led her to Christ. Acts 17, it says Paul, but later on, Paul opening the scriptures and taught them that Jesus is the Christ. So it's good to have someone who knows the Bible, opens the Bible, and says, that's what it says. For believers, Psalm 119, verse 18, open thou my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. There's one thing I have to tell you. When you preach verse by verse, sometimes you hit a problem. There's some verses in the Bible that are difficult to explain. And at one time in church, I mentioned that. You know, some of your verses are difficult. I might skip it. Someone might raise their hand, hey preacher, how about verse 4? Oh no. That's humbling, isn't it? But it's good to have these scriptures in one verse. I was going through Romans, and verse by verse, I said, Lord, I don't know. I looked ahead to see what was coming up. Lord, give me some hint, because I'm getting close to that verse. And the Lord gave me some insight I didn't have before. So God opened her heart in salvation. She's now a believer. Let's look now, Lydia, after salvation. It says, as she attended unto those things which were spoken by Paul. intensity in Christ. When someone's born again, I'm looking to see, what is their response? When a baby is born, we look for a response, right? A baby is born, what do you want them to do? You want them to kick and scream and holler and yell, right? You don't want them just to lay there. And my mother and dad, the first child, a daughter, was born dead. Full-term pregnancy, dead. 2 years later, they had a son, lived an hour, died. They were 41 when I came along, so you ladies know the biological clock was ticking down. Caesarean's how I arrived. So when a baby is born, what's the first thing you want to know? How is the baby doing? You know, they're doing fine. Sometimes there's the problem that they've got to deal with immediately, and sometimes mothers haven't been able to bring the baby home. Isn't that something? You have a baby, you can't bring it home because of medical. So for Christians, when a person says they accept the Lord, you want to see there's a change. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. So there's things there, and this word attend means to hold out to, she held on to. You can tell this person, Lydia, she knew the Lord as her Savior. Sometime ago, I was preaching at a church in Shoken, Pennsylvania, and there seemed to be a lady that she was really intense, and I could tell she was really into everything I was preaching. And later on, as I got to know her a little bit, I found out she was in a Jehovah's Witness family, husband, in-law, relatives. When she accepted Christ, it really made a change in her life. Can you imagine in marriage, being married to a Jehovah's Witness husband who shuns you, doesn't talk to you during meals, separate bedrooms? When she's shopping at the shopping center, if her relatives would see her, they would go a different aisle. But she had an intensity for the Lord. I could tell that lady loves the Lord. She's listening. When I talk sometimes about suffering. I was embarrassed. That lady was really going through some suffering for the Lord, but she held on to the truth of the Word of God and was a very strong Christian. Then we go to verse 15. And when she was baptized, remember we had the Ethiopian. He's going down in the desert. He gets baptized. We have Saul, he was baptized. We have Cornelius last week, he was baptized. Next week, Lord willing, we have the Philippian jailer, he gets baptized. Identification with Christ. You don't mind identifying with Jesus. I want people to know that I'm a Christian. I want them to be understanding. Now, in high school, maybe I bet you this or not, my freshman year and my senior year, I lived for the Lord. Those 2 middle years, I know we changed churches, and I could blame the church, but it's my own fault. I lived for the Lord my freshman year. I lived for the Lord my senior year. But I found out something. It was a little more difficult in my senior year because I'd been inconsistent the previous 2 years. So it took me almost, I had to be consistent for the whole year because they, well, Sam's just religious and on again and off again. And I didn't want that. So when I became a newspaper reporter, I made up my mind, day one, first night, before the night is over, they're going to know I'm a Christian. So I identified with the Lord, sought out, not in your face, not badgering them, just living for the Lord. And about a month later, they started calling me chaplain. They think I got through to it. I want people to know about Jesus. What, let a light shine, why? They may see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. So she wanted to be identified with Christ. Plus, it says in Matthew 28, you go therefore and teach all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Now, I understand in foreign countries, that comes with a price. When you baptize in an Islam country, you renounce Islam. In the Orient, with ancestor worship, when you worship Jesus and not your grandfather, it's quite a decision. But we identify with Jesus. In Acts 2:41, it says, they that gladly received his word were baptized, and God added 3,000 souls. So baptism is our identification with Christ. I mean, if he identifies with us, we certainly could identify with him. Then you'll note it also says, she was baptized in her household. As I mentioned, my wife didn't come from a Christian family. She was the first one to get saved. And they would say to her, is that all you've been told about? But over the years, we've seen the Lord work in my wife's family. I was pastor of First Baptist Church, Calvert County, when we started dating and married again. And then they invited us back to my wife's home church in the town where my in-laws live. My mother-in-law hadn't gone to church. And she said, if Sam becomes pastor of the church, I'll come every Sunday. Folks, that lady attended for 38 years. So she went to be the Lord. Now that's a faith. You talk about a mother-in-law. Second one, her son-in-law like me for 38 years. There came a change. Then Jackie's brother. Another brother. Then the sister-in-law. Then almost. And there are a number of people. We can look back now at our whole ministry. We believe that God had us in that area to win Jackie's family to the Lord. And one of our converts, Aunt Charlotte, is what, 90-something? 97 in a nursing home in Annapolis, but she still loves the Lord. And what she can do, she talks about the Lord and tells the Lord things. That was 1967, and Aunt Charlotte is still one for Jesus. So you do have this impact on your family, and she had that there. She shared her faith. That woman in Jacob's well, remember what it says? She said, come see a man that told me all things. Then later on, it says, they said to the lady, we believe what Jesus says, not because you said it, but because we heard him. So my purpose is, when you're finished here, we're finished here, you don't have to believe what I'm saying, as long as you believe what Jesus says. We want the people to follow him. And then an invitation from fellowship, it says, and she besought us, she said, you judge me faithful, come into my house. She besought us. She judged us. She wanted to be together. She wanted to be among Christians. When you know the Lord as your Savior, then you want to be among Christians. Good to see you. Instant fellowship. We have, in our community, there's a welcome committee. Guess who the welcome committee is? Jackie and I. We go welcome people. So we're the first ones that welcome them to our community. One of our neighbors, we hadn't even gone officially yet, and Lee's walking by here, and we made some comment, and I just simply said, yes, it's a good day the Lord has made. He turned around and said, you must be a Christian. Instantly, I knew our neighbors knew the Lord as our Savior, just because we talked a little bit about the Lord. And we enjoy community fellowship now because we're not only in the same community, but we're in the same family of God. So you want to have an invitation for fellowship. It says, we walk in the light as in the light. We have fellowship one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sins. Now, I've known you folks for about 2 years. I've known my high school classmates for 67 years. Would you agree? I don't know if you folks get along better than some of my high school classmates. I'm not sure. Some of them say they're with the Lord, but you ever talk to somebody and there's just not that response. When you know the Lord and you're with people who know the Lord, you want to share together. In the world, can't figure it out. Why? Our spirit bears witness. We're in the family of God. So this lady had a great impact. I think God had her very influential in the community to have that church in Philippi starting and becoming very strong. Now, we're going to look at the Philippian jailer next week, but there's a lot that happens right after this takes place. You want to read the rest of it. Paul Harvey would say, and now the rest of the story. It came to pass, the next verse, and what happened, and that is quite striking, that leads Paul, starts a church, and winds up in prison. But who can say? Prison guard. So that's our story for next week, the Lord tarries. Let's bow down in prayer. Father, we give thanks that we know you. Thank you for the fellowship we have, not because of us, because of Christ. We pray now that you will bless your word in Christ's name.
Each day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.